We have a talk on the Blank Mission by Jean-Luc Puget.
So it's a pleasure to be here to tell you about the Planck mission results. I'm not going to talk about the latest results, but the results to come in 12 days from now, the release and the legacy release of the Planck data will be made public on the 17th of July. Just a quick reminder that such big experiments, and we heard a number of comments like that about others, require a big collaboration, many people. And so, similarly to the LIGO-Virgo, there is more than 1,000 people have been working on the Planck collaboration, and so should at least remind all of you that many people, young people, work on that, and one difficulty is, as mentioned by the first speaker this morning, it's difficult to get them the recognition they need on that. Here you can see the 9 maps, which are the basic product from the survey of the Planck mission with the 2 instruments. And these ones are the ones to be published, as I said, on the 17th. But I would have put the 2015 release on that. You would not be able to distinguish them from those. And for temperature, in fact, you would not be able to distinguish at the same frequency from or similar frequencies from the one obtained by WMAP. So the differences on that rest in the details. Planck is the third generation CMB anisotropies experiment. And although it was conceived in 1993, basically in the same in similar years as WMAP, it's a much more complicated mission because it included radio type detection at low frequency and bolometers at 0.1 K temperature above absolute zero. And so the cryogenics of this mission was very complicated, and it came about much later, but with a much bigger sensitivity, which allows to make quite a difference on the polarization and not that much on the temperature. So when you separate, you use the 9 frequencies and separate the different components, you can get on the top left the CMB map, and you can get also the polarization, which is basically the polarization induced by the scattering at the last scattering surface. You remember that the CMB was predicted by Gamow and collaborators as a result of their model of helium seen in stars, and which could not be built inside the nuclear engine inside stars, could have been produced in the Big Bang. And this fantastically extrapolation, wild extrapolation of what we knew at the time, led to the prediction that we should observe the microwave background. And of course, the story was the discovery of the microwave background itself and its anisotropies and so on. And as expected, after the discovery by Penzias and Wilson, the prediction that if you measure well enough the anisotropies, you could really reconstruct the parameters of the cosmological model very well has been really coming to reality. So on the right side, you see the power spectra, which is the first tool that we are using, because the anisotropies are supposed to be from quantum origins. That's all what we know that could produce these fluctuations before the time where the helium synthesis started. And so you basically have a diabetic Gaussian and almost scale invariant fluctuations. And so you also generate polarization from the scattering at the last scattering surface, which is typically a redshift of 1300. In Planck, we also have one more step. We see the lensing effect of the structure when galaxies and clusters of galaxies form, large-scale structure. And so we also use that as a probe. What are the improvements from the 2015 data and release? Well, basically, we improved on the systematic effects. And as microwave experiments got more and more sensitive, unfortunately, it's more and more likely to have systematic effects being stronger than your noise. In Planck, the small scales were still in the regime of being dominated by the detector noise. And so we could really use the small scales, high multipoles in the power spectra very well. But it took us the 2015 to start using the large scale from the low frequency instrument to start with, because at the level of noise they had no obvious systematics, and I will tell you what that led to. But for the HFI, there was very obvious systematics at large scale that we could not get rid of. The quality of the data is estimated by making null tests, and you can make a number of them, different set of detectors. You could take the first year and the second year. You could take even 6 months apart two surveys which are scanned on the sky in two opposite directions, which gives a powerful tool to look at time effects and so on. So just looking at the odd-even surveys, the one which are scanned in different directions, that what was a residual on the maps, and you will have the scales are microkelvin. For the three top frequencies, it's 2 microkelvin, and for the highest frequencies, it's 10. And you can see intensity and polarization, and you could see basically a lot of large-scale residuals at that level. That's now for the 2018 results. And if you look at the second line at 143 gigahertz, you don't even see that galactic coordinate. And you don't even see any more residuals on the galactic disk. So that's a pretty impressive sign that we basically were able to kill the low frequency, the large-scale systematics. For the low-frequency instrument, same thing. It's a similar null test with the frequencies going from 30, 44, and 70 gigahertz. And you can see that at 70 gigahertz, at the level of 5 microkelvin, basically, you don't see anything also in the polarization. So that's what led us to use the polarization in 2015 from the large, the low-frequency instrument. That's a plot which is pretty busy, and I'm not going to describe it in detail. It's just to show that we have investigated, for both instruments, many systematics, and model them, confront them with different null tests. And so we believe that we understand very well that, and we use that to do end-to-end simulations. And of course, when you are not dominated by the noise, you need to use the simulations, and so we will, you will see that we use the likelihood based on simulations and not based on the assumption that we have a well-known Gaussian noise. Just to show an example of that, if you look at the, typically the 143, that's power sorry. That's results of using null test, for example, two half mission. And so you do cross spectra of these residuals, and you do difference. So you could see, for example, on the E modes, that's of all the polarization, you could see the acoustic peaks, which are predicted for the E modes. And you could see the rise, which is the rise of the dust, and the horizontal line in power spectra are the difference, and that's the noise. And the noise on the very left of this thing, at the very low multiple, you could see basically that the systematics were basically dominated with the noise. Thus, we needed to bottle these systematics to get to the bottom of it. That's even more true for 353. We could see for the dust, the small blue lines, the difference is basically we were at a factor of more than 100 from the noise there. For the low frequency instrument, for frequency 70, 44, and 33, you could see that at 30 gigahertz, for example, they are getting also less, they are getting some systematics over the extrapolated of the white noise. That's an example of how the simulations do represent well the data. You look on the right side, and just the blue and the red are two different null tests. It's the half mission or the difference between rings following each other. And you could not see that from where you stand, but basically there is a line in the middle of this red and blue band, which is the data, and the band is the simulation we made of that. And so you could see that basically we modeled well these systematic effects. And so we used these simulations to basically build the likelihood for the very low end. One example of how much do we improve the data. We calibrate on the kinetic motion of what we call the orbital dipole is a kinetic effect due to the Earth's motion around the sun, so it's a yearly change. But of course, we have also something which projects on the sky then, which is basically the motion of the solar system with respect to the background, which is the motion, the combined motion of the galaxy and of the orbital. And so this dipole, which is quite strong, it's 3 millikelvin, has a very large signal to noise in our experiments. And so it gives us a way to control the calibration very well. What we report here is the measurement of the direction and of the amplitude, starting with W map and going the 2015 and the 2018 results, which basically you could see the shrinking of the error bars. And so what you can see here, for example, is on the top, the direction. And what we do is to take several separation of components, four models, four algorithms. You can also see that we used from 30% and 60% of the sky. So you change the galactic cut you use to mask the galactic plane. So it's basically trying to tell us, if this is not changing, that you basically got rid of the galactic emission. And using all these, you could see how the direction and the amplitude here are stable. And as you could see, basically, all these determination per frequency, per sky cut, and per method of component separation all fit within a couple of arc minutes for the direction, which is pretty amazing, up to 353 gigahertz. And you could see the amplitude, which are well within 1 micro K out of the 3,360. Just using that, and I'm not going to go much further in this analysis we did of the quality of the data, the signal to noise on this dipole is typically 10 to the 5 per detector. So basically, we could and we should find a posteriori, when you look at the residual for the solar dipole, after we took the best estimate of it, between detectors and between frequencies, something which is of that order. The plot to the top there are for the four frequencies, 100, 143, 217, and 353. And you could see the RMS between detectors, and that they are all at the level that I reproduced on the left, below 10 to the 5 for the two main frequencies, and at the level of 10 minus 4 for the 353. So basically, we cannot do better. And you could see residuals also, dipoles for various surveys, the 5 surveys we have, for example, here. And you could see basically that it's basically noise for 100, 143. But you could see on the 353 odd even effect. So 353 is not yet fully cleaned of this type of systematics. Okay, that's just comparing frequencies, and I'm just jumping on that. That's a simulation which shows the effect of lensing on the CMB itself. So you could see, that's a small simulation, and you could see the temperature above on the top, the E modes, which are due to scattering, and the B modes, which, if any, could be induced by the primordial gravitational waves. And so that's without lensing, and if you include lensing, you could see, first of all, the various small shifts it does, and it converts part of the E modes into B modes. So this is also help to test the consistency. And so if you use higher order correlation, 4-point correlation, just remove the expected from the 2-point correlation effect, you basically can measure the power spectrum of the lensing gravitational potential. And so the black curve is the best prediction from the best model, Planck, and the measurement 2013 and 2015, and 2018 is not here, but it's just a small improvement of the error bars, are very well, it's completely consistent. Non-Gaussianity was tested, and it's tested with better numbers of each generation, and basically, there's not much to say about that. Let me come to the cosmological parameters. That's the 2015 ones. And for those of you, I would put reference of 2015 or 2018, and on 2018, I put the Planck number of the 12 papers that will come out in 10 days, 12 days. The 6 parameters are, the main parameters are the one here. It's a baryonic fraction, the cold dark matter, the acoustic horizon, basically, and tau, which is the optical depth from reionization. The universe, when it's neutralized at a redshift of 1,000, free the CMB we see. And of course, when the first objects form, the universe is reionized, and then there is some scattering of the, and some, basically, you wipe out some of the, for example, the high peaks, the high acoustic peaks. So the optical depth, which is gone through by the CMB, is one crucial parameter, and which is just the Thomson optical depth of the electron. You could see here that this was typically 8%, 7.8%. You could also do extensions. So you can, in that way, you can check the assumption on the so-called lambda CDM, the one which has dark energy, the lambda term, and called dark matter. And this model is still the one we are trying to break, and we have not yet broken it. That would be a sign of new physics. We are looking for that, and the model resists to the improvement of the... So, for example, this model says that the inflation period, which is the best paradigm we have to generate the fluctuation, the quantum fluctuation, and bring them to microscopic scale, would basically make the universe with a very flat space geometry. So the curvature, omega k, should be very close to zero. And basically, combining either the temperature plus lensing, temperature plus lensing plus polarization EE, basically gives you increasing quality and always still center on zero. And you can do other things, and I will come to, for example, neutrino masses or number of species of relativistic species that could be not in the standard model. And I will discuss that later. So what's the evolution of the parameters? Well, the parameters, except for tau, the optical depths, are not changing very much. Basically, the picture stays the same, and it stays coherent with the lambda CDM. The optical depths, tau, to the reionization, can be measured almost independently of the other parameters by what it induces on large scale. Large scale meaning tens of degrees on the sky. So the place where, unfortunately, the systematics were the strongest. And I will show you the history of the tau parameter. And so what we claim now in the parameter paper to come is that tau is driving most of the significant changes in parameters, which are typically one of order one sigma, most of the other being a fraction of a sigma. This is a historical plot that is coming from the first paper we did between the 2015 and the 2018 data, when we started to believe that we had gotten the systematics of the low of the high frequency, knowing that in 2015 we used the low frequency instrument, which sought to have also corrected the systematics. That was, for the most, true, but not completely. And so you can start from the top, with the various WMAP rendering of this. The very first one, in fact, is just a blue spot here at 0.17. Then it was done on TE on the very first measurement. The other ones you could look at were still between 0.1, 0.08 and 0.1. And the Planck one, shrinking the error bars, were getting, for the 2015 release, typically still at the 0.08 measurement, for example, for TT and OP. And so we did, in an intermediate paper, the one which used the simulations and did a likelihood which was based on the simulations. And so when people were using many simulations of the CMB and the noise, tens of thousands, we could do only 350. We had 300 simulations, which cost a lot of computing time. And so it's not as accurate, but the models are probably not that much more accurate than that, a few percent. We found, basically, that it was even lower than what we had said, that the tau was 5.5%. And we did that with a number of different rendering of the likelihood, and we also combine the low frequency with we crossed the cross spectra between the 70 gigahertz and 100, or 70 gigahertz with 143. The 70 being the one we had used in 2015, and which was giving a somewhat higher number. And when we did that, basically, the systematics are different enough that we kill basically the systematics from both instruments. So that's what we got. And what was in I'm lost my 2018. So that's the 2018 parameters, and you can see that the tau is basically either you use baryon acoustic oscillation or Planck alone, 5.44 or 5.61, and it was 5.5. There is one combination of things which gives a 5.0%. So all of that is within the uncertainties of 0.7%. So basically, tau now is stable. I think for the first time in history of, I'm convinced it's stable. So you will find in the publication this kind of plots, which shows for the different parameters how they evolve with time through these WMAP Planck things. And the interesting results for physics is basically that the small tau allows to put a better limit on the mass of neutrinos and of the effective number of relativistic species. And you could see that when we combine for the Planck plus the Lenzing plus the BAO, we get basically an upper limit, which is close to 0.1 EV. And the standard model of particle physics tells us that to distinguish between the two hierarchies of neutrinos, you getting lower than 0.1 would give basically a strong constraint on that. So we are getting there. And for the effective number of relativistic species, basically no evidence for anything else. So that's where we are. I've not talked about R, which is the ratio of tensor to, and that will be, we will talk about that, in fact, in the last session this afternoon, me first, and then Lyman Page will tell us how he hopes to get a real measurement of that. We have no evidence for measurement of R. Thank you.
Thank you. Comments? Please. Yes, there is one there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a quick question. Is there any improvement in constraining the topological defects in the new release data by Planck with respect to all this one?
Yeah, there is a paper coming out of that which looks at all topological defects and basically statistical non-isotropy, for example, and so on. The number refine the numbers, but there is no evidence for anything which would be bigger, something giving any sign of detection.
Okay, so more questions? Actually, I have a comment on the H naught. So do you have any determination of the H naught?
Yes, I had one slide after on H naught, but basically H naught, that's the one. There is a tension with H naught, as you we know, and as the other tension, for example, with sigma 8 and so on, were going down now a bit. H naught didn't change with tau. The small scale polarization is enough to keep the H not at the same level in Planck, but the supernovae and recital get a rise of the number. And so we are getting in a situation where you could see basically the blue thing, which is the last rendering of that, in a plot of H not omega matter on NF H not. And basically, that's now a 3.8 sigma discrepancy. So the discrepancy with H naught is getting larger.
Okay, thank you, Jean-Loup again. And we reconvene at 11:15.